that's one of the conditions for being crazy. So there's a question they teach you in graduate school to ask psychotic people to see how, if they really are psychotic. And it's like, if the TV's off and they're in my office and they're telling me, Chris, the TV's talking to me, man, it's telling me to do things. And I go, okay, is there any possibility that could not be true? If they say, no, it's absolutely true, I just go, oh, we just need to get to the hospital. We're going to get you medicated, right? Now, once you get medicated and you get back, get the dopamine levels in your brain back down to normal, and then, you know, then we can have a conversation. But you don't have to, we don't have to agree on it right now, right? And once you get uncrazy, they're always grateful at the end. Because they're like, oh, Chris, going crazy is frightening. Once I was there, I didn't care. I don't know, right? I'm just crazy. Okay, so that's the hard part. And that, you know, there's all saying, to my sponsor used to say, that's why, like, only crazy people have to be right all the time. So one of the red flags if you start dating, if you date somebody that always has to be right, run. Right? Because that's a personality disorder issue, then, if they're not actively psychotic. If they always have to be right and they're that rigid with it, run. No flexibility. That's a huge red flag. So, because, you know, in a conflict, people want three things. They want a safe face, look good, and be right. But the person like that, they always have to be right. So you are always going to lose. Those are the people that don't go for win-win situations. In a conflict, they say, if I'm going to lose, everybody's losing. Okay? So run. All right? Okay, so, and in the front of your folder, there's a little sheet there that you can write down the date of whatever class that we're on. There are 12 of them. And it just keeps going around and around and around. Okay, so after you finish these 12, you don't have to stay in here again. You can go. And go out to a meeting on Tuesday night. Take a nap. Do something, right? Some self-care. I highly suggest getting out of the house. It's a good thing to get away from here. To go invest out there. If you don't invest out there before you leave the house, nothing out there will be valuable. Right? So if you don't keep investing in something, it won't be valuable. I mean, first went to AA with my sponsor. We started going. I was like serious about it. I'd only be going 3 months, and I said, Bill, you know what? Sometimes these meetings just suck. I'm not really all that into it, right? I'm not connecting yet. And he said, how long did you get high? And I said, 15 years. You've been going to meetings for 3 months? 15 years, 3 months. What have you invested more? And I said, using. He goes, why would this be more valuable then? He said, I think that's unrealistic. It's unreasonable. It's unkind to do to yourself to say, I should be excited. Right? That old saying in AA is a while before the have to's become the want to's. Okay? So, every week we cover a different topic related to sobriety. And tonight we're going to talk about the topic of balance and why that's so important. So, the way I'll start this off is if you think about, like, why do you think that they say in recovery that we get clean and sober? What's that?
Some people
finally take a bath. Oh, okay, that's true. Yeah, taking a shower for me, that was a big one, right? Early recovery. Just get my ass to the shower and not being stinky anymore. Because you can be clean and then get sober. You can't be sober if you're not clean. You can learn about recovery. There are people that have been through, like, I was through treatment 8 times by the time I was 24. 8 30-day inpatient treatments by the time I was 24. Okay? I could teach classes on addiction and substance abuse, but I didn't know anything about recovery because I had never experienced recovery. You can't start experiencing, if you don't experience something, you don't know it. Right? You can't know it. Like, if you had a friend that had never had sex, could you explain to him what having sex was really all about? Not just the fun stuff, but all the drama and bullshit that can come with it too. Okay? It's not just one thing, is it? Right. Okay? Sobriety's the same way. Until you make a commitment, until you're convinced that you do not have an off switch, that going back to alcohol and drugs, whatever it is, mood altering substance, eventually it's going to run the show and not you. It's going to take more than it's going to give. And there's going to be more pain than pleasure. I have never met a person yet that is willing to actually start participating in recovery. Because if you're not convinced, you won't go through the grieving process because you'll be bargaining with yourself. Well, let me try this. Let me try that. Let me try this. You never embrace the loss. If you don't say, I will experience the loss. So I know people are serious about recovery when they say, I don't care what happens. There are no more what ifs. Like, well, what if this happens? What if that? Whatever. But they go, it doesn't matter what happens. There's not a valid reason for me to drink or use drugs. There's lots of excuses. There's lots of things that will make you think about it, right? Okay, especially the first couple of years of recovery. But until a person reaches that, you know, I'm a recovery therapist. I work at Community Corrections. I've run 3 treatment programs in town. And when I see people coming in, they go, I'm not ready. I go, okay. And they go, what? I go, so, like, you're not convinced yet, are you? And they go, no. And then I say, so, you're not willing to say, I'll commit to long-term abstinence. And then, if I got to get rid of this, I'll have to put something else in its place, so I'll start exploring where that's going to be. Until they do that, there's no point in talking to them about 12-step programs, about all these other kind of things. About, you can expose them to that, right? Maybe plant a seed. You know, I've heard at like 12-step meetings, there's more that's caught than taught, usually. Okay. You show up and you just get information and it just kind of goes in there. Once it's in there, it doesn't leave. So, but until a person is reaching that point where they go, I'll do whatever it takes not to drink or use, I'll put as much energy into that as I did into practicing my addiction, because I'm convinced to go over here, I will lose something that means as much as my life to me. And that is different for each person, right? Some people go to prison. Some people will lose their kids. Some people will die. They, you know, it's like, I don't know what that is, what that body is for people, but I do know it's different for each person. So, I mean, it took me getting cancer and then the judge being done when I was 24. That's what it took for me. So, you know, that's why when people come in for like an assessment, sometimes they'll go, oh, you're going to tell me I'm going to drunk, right? Or I'm a dope fiend and I got to go to meetings. And I go, I don't know. I've known you for half an hour. How could I possibly know that? But I do know that you know the truth. And that's the only person that has to know it. You're the only person that has to know the truth about what happens when you put alcohol or drugs in your body. You are the only person that has to know. Okay? So, if you say, I'm convinced, you start moving into grief. If you say, I got to give this up and put this over and start investing in something else over here. Okay? So that's why clean, you can learn about sobriety, but you can't experience it until you're actually grieving the loss of your relationship, your active relationship with alcohol and drugs, that using, that instant relief, okay? So until you go through that, all you can do is learn about recovery and be exposed to it. So, you know, and you know, I didn't waste 8 years in treatment. I was a much more well-informed addict, right? Practicing addict. I could quote the big book. The NA book, I sounded really good. But until you start practicing it, it doesn't matter. So balance. So that's why clean, everybody gets clean first, right? So like on this one page here, it says like, that's what abstinence is up here. So abstinence is the process of, and just getting clean for some people is so much harder than for some other people. Some people come in and just go, I'm done, and they just get it. And I used to hate those people. They didn't seem to struggle a lot when they first came in. I was like, ah, Bill, like, I am obsessed. I just, he says, He says, you're a later stage addict, Chris. You are more equipped, more overwhelmed, more wounded, and less equipped than most people coming into treatment and into recovery. So, of course, it's going to take you longer to heal, right? You're going to feel uncomfortable for a bit longer. And you're going to struggle more with, because you used alcohol and drugs for more things than maybe other people did. Your whole life was centered around it. So, of course, it's going to require more time to heal from that obsession, the compulsion, and then the physical complications, too. So, so that's the beginning of recovery, is abstinence. That's not the goal, though. The goal of recovery isn't just to get clean. Clean is just clean. And then if you don't start healing all the parts of your life that were affected, if you don't start developing the thriving skills maybe that you never got because addiction threw you into survival mode, depending on how old you were when you started, you know, relying on it and depending on it more for a lot of other things in your life, you can't, there's no way that you can actually move forward into like starting to figure out, oh, sobriety is about healing all those areas of my life and learning how to manage my addictive personality. Because personalities never change. So your personality is kind of like your hardwiring. Like if you hit on a computer keyboard like the letter S, it's always going to type S, right? So your personality is kind of like the hardwiring on a computer. It's in place by the time you're 8 to 12 years old. Doesn't change much after that. And it's the filter you see the world through. And it's the way you tend to react to the world when it first presents itself to you. Okay? So addicts and alcoholics, when you have an addictive personality type, we all have certain traits that are pretty common to all of us. And those are the traits that you manage with structure, boundaries, and discipline. All personality disorders, if you want to call that, or personality challenges, require structure, boundaries, and discipline around them, and ownership. You've got to be able to own it. So, you know, addicts and alcoholics, we tend to be extremists, right? We go to one extreme or the other. We're perfectionists. We can be the best of the best, or we just don't try. So if we're extremists, it also means that like addicts tend to be really, like late-stage addicts tend to be very intellectual, like very, like, they're creative and they're smart people, right? Because only smart people can convince themselves a bad idea is a good one over and over again. You can't be dumb and do that. So never met a dumb late-stage addict yet. Right? Because you have to be intelligent to be, and creative and adaptive and determined and brilliant and persistent to convince yourself to go back to something that you've proven to yourself maybe that like it's going to run the show eventually anyway, not me. So you can't be dumb. Okay? So that's one. We also tend to be very sensitive people from a young age. Not only are we more passionate about our vocations or our relationships, we're more loyal, we're like very trustworthy people, okay? But we're also incredible, so we feel more of those emotions, the positive, but we also feel more when we have injustice or unfairness or criticism or inequality, we're treated, you know, unfairly. We feel that more than other people do. And that's a breeding ground for resentment in AA or NA or in recovery in general, okay? It's like, you said what, okay? That's the other part, is that we're also very oppositional. And most of us are that way from a young age. So, and you know you're this way, is if when you were a kid, someone told you to do something, if it made sense and you didn't like doing it, you went, all right, I'll do it, I don't like doing it, but I'll do it, okay? But if you were young and they told you and they couldn't explain why, and you were like, oh, hell no. We dig our heels in, we get stubborn, I'm not doing it, and you just told me to do it, that's why I'm not doing it, right? So I'm like, I'm a kid and I'm going out to mow the lawn, and I wanted to, it was a nice day, it was whatever, go outside, get some fresh air, had my hand on the door, my mom said, you get out there and mow that lawn. It's no longer my idea. And I went, bitch, what'd you say? Like, I'm 12, right? You know, it's the only time I ever called my mom a bitch. Because she whooped my ass into that, right? I mean, like, she got bigger as she was walking toward me, you know? Like, she said, what do you say? I said, come on. My dad was overseas. He was a fighter pilot in the Navy at the time. And I'm thinking, I'm 12, right? My mom was only 5'2". I got up to 5'11". I mean, I was up at 5'1" tall. Like, I was only an inch away from her. I thought, yeah, come on, woman, bring it on, right? You know, at 12, she kicked my ass, okay? That's all I got to say. That woman went off. So, but that's that oppositional thing, right? Okay, like, no, I'm not going to do it. So that doesn't change just because we get sober. That's why it's easy to get the fuck it's in AA. Especially if you have any kind of authority over you when you're first getting sober, right? Everybody has some kind of authority over them. Nobody has ultimate power over you because even God won't take away your free will. But get a shitty boss. Get a judge in a bad mood. Get a PO cranky, right? Get, you know, we all have authority over us in some way or the other, all right? So we tend to have difficulties with authority figures, all right? So that's one of those, some of those other traits that we all tend to have, okay? So we manage those for the rest of our life. They never go away, all right? Our character is a daily choice, though. Character is the thing that you develop, you heal, and you keep growing on a daily basis in recovery. And all the steps, like in a 12-step program, really are based around like identifying what are the deficits that I had. Like I grew up in an alcoholic, violent, crazy, abusive home. I was in survival mode by the time I was 3 on. People weren't thriving, we were surviving, right? So we didn't have time to sit down and like get all the social skills and get all the relationship skills and get all the coping skills that when you grow up in a healthy family, when you're overwhelmed as a kid, where people go, hey, let me help you calm down. You seem overwhelmed, you seem upset. What are you feeling? What do you need right now? That's what healthy adults are supposed to do for kids. They're supposed to show up that way. You know, if you have a practicing alcoholic in your house growing up, it ain't happening. Because there are 3 rules in an addicted family. Don't trust, don't feel, and don't talk about it. Those are the rules you gotta follow, okay? So you grow up emotionally disconnected, emotionally illiterate, and you know, it's even harder for men because the only feeling you're allowed to have as a man growing up really is anger. All the other ones get villainized, they get, you know, you're told that somehow you're weak if you're feeling sad, if you're feeling anxious, you know, fearful, anything like that. So you're not allowed to have those feelings. That's why boys from the age of 10 to 18, after the age of 10, boys know that it's not okay to put your arm around your best friend anymore because people call you names. Little boys do it all the time. Come here, buddy, like that. Like after that, no, it's like bump you, do whatever. You know, it's like you're not gonna hug, you don't do those kind of things. Right? So boys from the age of 10 to 18 are 50% more likely than girls to complete suicide. Because they got so much feeling, they got so much going on in them they're never allowed to deal with. Okay? They're overwhelmed, they're depressed, they're sad, they might have lost it, but they can't own them. They can act them out if you're aggressive. But what happens if your boy is not into sports? Then you fight. So boys that 75% more likely to start using alcohol around 10 to 12 years old in pot than girls. Right around that age. Okay? So from 18 to 30, men are 75% more likely to commit suicide and complete it. And that's not even if you've been in the military. If you've been in the military, it's higher, the rate. I grew up in a military family. Someone said, why didn't you like go to the Naval Academy, Chris, like your dad? And I said, by the time I left home, you know, I've been around that man for 21 years. I deserve a pension. Living in that military crazy-ass family, okay? Because the military families are all about keep up the image. Don't talk about what happens in this house, you know? Like, we were always told that if you're not a good, you know, soldier or whatever it is, like, what's the Navy, like, cadet? No, it's not a cadet. Seaman, whatever it is, okay? So, like, you're going to destroy this family. We were told that in the 60s and 70s growing up. So I was like, oh, crap. Like, remember I told you I went to my friend Bruce's birthday party when he was 11 and I asked, where's the keg? Right? And his mom's like, because I've been drinking and getting high since I was 10. My dad let me drink. And I was like, where's the keg? And Bruce's mom was going, we got a cake. And we got a clown and we got a pin the tail. Like, we ain't got no keg. Like, I think you need to go home and I don't want you playing with Bruce, right? Okay, she calls my mom by the time I get home and she goes, Teresa, what's going on at your house? Chris is saying, like, why isn't there a keg? And she goes, oh, you know Chris, he's just a liar. Mm. When I got home, I got my ass whooped. You do not talk about what goes on in this house. That's when I knew 11. Oh, shit. I'm in a concentration camp, but told I'm supposed to love the guards. Oh, you can't win in that situation. Psychologically, in clinical terms, they call that a double bind. Damned if you do, damned if you don't. And what it creates is learned hopelessness and learned helplessness. There's nothing I can do to help myself. Nobody cares. And then it's hopeless. And you can only push those feelings down by yourself for so long before you have to start grabbing stuff outside of you, right? Like, when I got sober at 24, I said to my sponsor, I'm smarter than this. I should not have become addicted. Like, I've been in treatment 8 times. I shouldn't be here having cancer at 24 and having, you know, the legal system done with me. They're pissed. And he said, well, how old were you when you started drinking at 10? And I said, at 10, right? And getting high. He goes, who the hell needs to get high at 10? I said, you grew up in my family, Bill? That was the only thing around that helped me from not killing my dad or myself. He goes, so wasn't it brilliant at the time? And creative? And determined? And persistent? How can we shame anything that helped you survive? Nothing heals with shame, Chris. You have to embrace this. So he said, what step do you think you're on a 12-step program? I said, Bill, I've been through treatment like 8 times. I bet I'm on like at least 5 or 6, right? And so he said, really, here's one question I'll ask you and it'll tell us exactly where you're at. Said, when your addiction talks to you, do you thank it for showing up? Are you really grateful for it? I said, hell no, I'm not grateful. I got cancer. And the judge is done, right? He said, oh, you've never taken step one. Really? You've never taken step one. You've named that you have an addiction, but you've never owned it. Because that means you're
in the hospital.
Cool. All right. Good luck with your dad. Hope he's all right.
Yep.
See you, man. So he says, you've never owned it. To admit something means to grant admission, to like bring it in. You know, like, John's been to some meetings with me, like, and we've talked about this before, that, like, when I hear people at a meeting say you all the time, well, what you got to do is, and, you know, when you get to that point, and when you got that, and when you got to do this, and whatever, I go, oh, they've never owned it. It's when I hear people say I. Right? So everybody I sponsor, when they said, oh, if I was you, and I said, don't say that, that's putting the problem out here still. I did this. I am here. I'm feeling it. We have to start owning that, right? And he said, so you've never owned it. You've talked about it a lot. You've been mad at it a lot, but you've never actually owned it and thanked it for helping you survive. He said, but that's just the nature of addiction. It gets bigger than you and it's going to kill you in the end. So he said, at least you're at 24 and you're finally convinced you're going to die. Some people never get it. You know, my dad died last year, a drunk at 82. Never got it. Because he had more money than God. Money's a great enabler, let me tell you, okay? So, you know, your character is the things that you don't get to develop when you grow up wounded, overwhelmed, in survival mode. And so you're thrown into survival mode, and your character has 3 components, like it says here. There's your integrity, and it's the 5 parts of yourself that, you know, you get attended to, that people pay attention to and help you nurture and develop as you're growing up. Like your physical self, how do you take care of yourself physically? They pay attention to your emotions. They ask you to explore your spirituality. Well, what does that mean to you? What does the higher power look like to you? Those are the things that healthy families do. Socially, they teach you the skills. They teach you like healthy relationship dynamics. They teach you all those kind of things. And you know, intellectually, they challenge you, okay? That doesn't happen in an overwhelmed, addicted family because people aren't talking about things. Your moral code, if you practice an addiction, your moral code is basically what's right versus wrong. Like, you know, don't lie, cheat, or steal. Practice the platinum rule in life, not the golden rule. You know, the golden rule is treat other people like you want to be treated. That's still a little selfish. The platinum rule is treat other people the way they want to be treated. Ask them, how does love look to you? How does it matter to you? It doesn't matter. If I give you love in a way that doesn't matter to you, what the hell does it matter? Right?
Say that again, Chris.
Okay, I'll give you an example. Okay? I have a guy that I'm sponsoring right now, right? I've been working with him a little over a year, and he takes naltrexone. He was getting Vivitrol and naltrexone because he's an opiate addict, right? Stops you from, it's a blocker, so it stops you from, if you get high, it stops you from blocking it, right? Okay? So, he's been sober for over a year. He doesn't need to take the naltrexone every day now, right? But, he's died four times, right? He's 26, he's died four times. And I'm not breaking his confidentiality, don't make it share his story. So I always ask, right, so just so you know. I won't talk about any of you unless you tell me it's okay. And so he's died four times. The last time, his fiance, had to kick the door in because he had died next to his two-year-old and had to get revived with Narcan, right? So had died. And so she said, you have to be sober for at least a year before I'll agree to marry you, which she has now. But she said, for the first 3 years, anytime that I want to, you need to take an naltrexone, and she has drug screens at her house, like drug tests. At any time I want, if I think you're looking squirrely or something, for the next 3 years, I want you to take a drug test whenever I want to give you one. Right? When she first said that, he was like, because you know, if you take naltrexone and you've been using, oh, it'll stop you from dying, but you know what? It'll slam you into withdrawal too. You feel like you're gonna die. Okay, it's awful. Okay, so at first he was like, well, I can't believe she doesn't trust me yet, Chris. That's bullshit. Whatever. I said, hey, you've been sober a year, right? You had one lapse during that time, actually. So I said, on a scale of 1 to 10, on your worst day, how much do you trust yourself not to use right now? He goes, oh, 3 or 4. I said, so you can't ask her to trust you more than you trust yourself. You're not allowed to do that yet. So if that's what she needs to believe that you're serious about your recovery, does it hurt you in any way if you're working your program? No. I'm not going to go into withdrawal, right? If I don't have it in me. I said, take the damn pill whenever she asks you to take the pill. You have to work your way back into her heart. Your addiction made you break that trust with her. You didn't wake up that morning going, oh, hope, you know, I abandoned my kid and scared the hell out of my fiance and whatever, right? Nobody ever drove home with their kid in their own school and I can't wait to screw you up. Right. It doesn't work that way, okay? But you did. Your addiction took you there, so you know what? You're responsible for your recovery. If that's what she needs, do it. And don't bitch about it. You can bitch about it to me. Oh, I can't believe this, whatever. Do not do that to her. And now he does. That's the platinum rule. Giving love to somebody in a way that matters to them, not to you. Because if all he said was, I promise and I'm sorry, and see I got a sponsor now, I'm working these steps, blah, 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 blah. It's not what she needed to feel safe. And then he's still selfish. She's going to look at him and go, see, you're still a selfish prick. It's all about you. You never asked me what I knew. That's how you make amends. You ask them what they need. And that requires character. Okay? So, and then the last part about that is your values. Like, it's what's important to you. That's why I said you can't show up at the beginning and think meetings are going to be important. It's a choice to go at the beginning, not a feeling. It will if you wait for the feeling to hit you to go to a meeting, you'll never go in early recovery. And there's even a saying in 12-step programs, when do you need to go to a meeting the most? When you want to go the least. That's when you choose. You know, I really, like, words are really important to me. And when people come in and, you know, they're desperate, they go, I want to get better, Chris, and I need to get better. And I go, I don't care. And they think I'm real shitty, right? You know, they think that I'm, oh, you're just insensitive, you're this, you're rude, you're whatever. And I go, you wanted it and needed it before. People don't get better till they choose it. And you have to keep choosing it, even when you don't feel like it. It's a while before the have-tos become the want-tos at the beginning. But you have to be convinced that everything that you've done will not work before you're going to be open and have some conviction and willing to listen and follow other people's direction. You have to be convinced that everything you've tried hasn't worked. And if you're not there yet, there's nothing I can do to make you get there until you're there. I don't fight that battle. So I love it when people come in and they go, I'm not convinced, I'm not whatever, I'm gonna think I'm gonna try. And I go, what does your harm and risk reduction plan look like then? How are you gonna protect yourself? It's not elimination, because if you're gonna use, there's always a risk. How are you gonna protect yourself? Right? And then you can find out if you really have an off switch or not. Who knows? I don't know. I just met you a few minutes ago, okay? So here's one of the things that my sponsor said to me. Like, so we were looking at all these parts of myself and my character. When I got to step 4 and 5, he did step 4 totally differently than any treatments that I've ever been in. He said, Chris, step 4 says you made a searching and fearless what?
Moral
inventory of yourself. He said it is not an immoral inventory of yourself. People have this concept, he said, I don't know how this changed, but in 1950 when I got sober, that's not... Today, they have you write down like all the things, the way you hurt people, all the terrible things, blah, blah, blah. And that's what you share in your fist step and everything. And he goes, that is not the way we did it. He says, at least in New York, where I got sober, Chris, we didn't do it like that way back then. We looked at it as, step 4 is when you're starting to identify, what kind of man do you actually want to be in recovery? You started identifying what are the character traits that you're going to strive to achieve and maintain as a man in recovery for the rest of your life. Because if character is the only thing you can change and grow and develop, you know, because he said your character is your legacy. It is what people remember about you, right? People can leave you a lot of money, right? My mom left me a lot of money. But even if she didn't, I would remember her fondly because she was a great woman, right? My dad left me a lot of money when he died last year. I never think about him. I'm grateful for the money, right? You know, because the lack of money can make you miserable, right? Money alone won't make you happy, but the lack of it sure can make you miserable, okay? So money just gives you the opportunity to explore your talents, gifts, and skills more. And freedom to choose. That's all it really gives you. Okay? I mean, Elvis died stoned and alone on the throne, right? With 40 pounds of shit in him. Because he was so backed up from all the bike that he had in him, right? Okay? He was not a happy man at the end. But he had more money than God. Alright? So your character's the thing that you work on constantly. And so we had to identify, I had to start writing down all the things that how I wanted people to remember me. So he had three exercises that he had me do. The first one was like I had to like imagine myself at my funeral and that somebody got up to talk about me and the only thing they could tell, like they were compelled and they got all this insight about who I really was. Not what I showed the world, but who I really was and what I really did. And that's what they were going to talk about. And he said, how do you want people to remember you? How do you want people to talk about you, right? And then the other thing I had to do was write down, like if I had anybody that I admired from, like, history or, like, mentors in my life or people that I admired, like, what are the qualities about them that you admire, right? So I had to write that down. And then there was one more, I can't remember what was it. My brain's going a little dead right now. But anyway, that's the general thing. Like, so he said, we got to set a benchmark and a goal about where we're going to go. And I was like, well, I've never done step 4 that way before, Bill. I said, why do they call it searching and fearless then? If we're just going to identify what we want to be. And he said, because anything you put on that piece of paper, you have to commit to me that you're going to keep working on. And once you put it down there, we're not taking it off. So I'm sitting here going, okay, like I started working on it right. And, you know, like I was such a huge thief in my addiction. I mean, literally, it took me a year to stop shoplifting. It was like really hard, right? And I just lied a lot because I mean, Addicts lie just a lot. It just came out, right?
Boom.
Okay. So Bill said, I put down honesty when I went to go back and read the talk by step 4. He goes, really? So you know you're committing to working on this, right? He goes, now, I trust you, Chris, that you're not going to be cash register dishonest because you've realized I don't have to like have you empty your pockets anymore when we leave the store. And like every time I came out of his bathroom, right, and he lived at the rectory, he was a priest, right? Every time I came out of the rectory at his house, out of the bathroom at the rectory, he would be standing by the door going, empty your pockets. You were in there for a long time. Are you stealing my shit? Right, you know, I go, ah, Bill, right? I mean, it took him like 9 months to stop doing that, okay? So he says, I believe you that like shit's not leaving my house, right? So I don't have to worry about getting arrested with you when I go to the store, you know, all that kind of stuff. And so I believe cash register, but he goes, we're talking honesty on every level. So he goes, Chris, you know, one of the things you're still struggling with is lying just to lie. It just comes out automatically, which we all do in recovery because we're just so conditioned to lie. And, you know, about covering ourselves when we feel insecure or overwhelmed. And so he said, so you're telling me that you're committing to, for the rest of your life, every time that you become aware there's a lie coming out of your mouth, you'll admit, like, what's your first name?
Derek.
So like, let's just lie to Derek, right? And as he says, as soon as you get awareness of that, you turn to Derek and go, Derek, I'm sorry, man, I just lied to you. I bold-faced lied to your ass. Oh, my God, that's one of the things I'm trying to change in recovery. I apologize for that. Like, what do I have to do to repair the damage I just caused?
You said you're sorry, it's okay.
Okay, but you know what? Like, why don't you think about it? He said, give me a little time to think. Because a lot of times people aren't used to you being that honest, Chris. And they'll go, motherfucker, you what? Right, you know? Like, listen, we're all upset. You got a little time to think about it, right? Okay. So he said, give him time to think. I was like, I'm not putting that down there. He goes, why not? And I said, that's embarrassing. And he said, wow, you can do everything in recovery but be dishonest, Chris. So are you willing to, like, work on the willingness to get it down there eventually? I said, oh, I guess so. He goes, good answer, because if you said no, I've told you to get the hell out of my house. Because there are people out there that will do whatever it takes to stay sober. It took a little while, right? So, and it was hard when I first started doing that. Like, when I would, like, lie to people in recovery, they would get it, right? So I just lied to you, man. They go, oh, good for you. You're working on that, right? Right. You're working on building your character, okay? But at the time I was getting sober, I was dancing professionally in New York City at the Joffrey Ballet Company. And, like, I've shared the story that some of you have heard before. I'm sorry to bore you again with it. But when you come to the company, you start down here as an apprentice. Then you get up to the company. Then you get up to here to be a soloist. And then you get up here to be a principal, right? Those are the 4 tiers that you go to. I'm down here at the company level. Finally worked up for the... I'm at the company level. And there's a principal dancer up here. Her name is Gelsie. Darcy, and she was like the bomb, right? She was a big attraction for the company. She made them a lot of money. And I was her partner's understudy. So if anything happened to him, I got to go on, right? So one night, he broke his foot. Chris, change your costume, go on with Darcy. Like, we ran on. And when you dance with a woman on stage, most of the time, we're talking to each other, right? Like, you're lifting her up, you're going, girl, you better jump, right? Okay, then you're working around, get up on your leg, do whatever. And she's like going, don't drive me, turn me this way. So you're always under your breath talking. Very, very rarely do you have somebody that you don't have to talk to. You just, like, got this thing, man. Like, and I had that with Darcy. We're like, oh. And we got off stage, and we didn't talk the whole time. It was incredible. And she said, what was that? That was awesome, right? And I said, I know, Darcy. Oh, God. That was, wow. And so she started asking for me more. Can I work with Chris? Can I work with whatever? Can I do this right? You know, and I'm like going, yeah, right? Okay? And so, like, we're getting along great. I'm starting to, like, get more, like, recognition getting up here. And we went to a party one night. And I go in the bedroom to get my coat. And she was dating this, like, guy from South America or something like that. I turn around to get my coat. Literally, he grabs me. Pushing me up against the thing and puts like this lip lock on me, right? And I'm going, dude, what is going on? Like, seriously? I have not sending you this signal.
Because you know, Darcy is going to kick my ass. Like, oh my God, you're jeopardizing my moving up in the company. What are you doing? Whatever, like that. And
finally got out of there or whatever. So the next day, Darcy walks up to me. She goes, "Hey, Chris, Carolyn said yesterday at the party last night that she walked past there and she saw some funny business between you and Joaquin. So, what happened?" "Nothing. She must have been seeing something." Totally lied to her. Totally lied to her, right? And I'm sitting there going, oh, crap. It was so automatic because I was embarrassed, right? And afraid that I was going to lose my position, that I was working so hard to go up there. I'm like, oh, crap. And then I thought, I called my sponsor and said, "Bill, I just lied to lie." And he goes, "Oh, so you're going to go tell her, right?" I was like, "What? No, I'm not going to go tell her." And he says, "Really? Then you just fired yourself from this relationship. Because you made a commitment to your character, and that's what we change in recovery as men." And he said, "Wow, are you willing to pray for the willingness?" Shit, all right, you know. So I go tell her, and she did not react like everybody in recovery did. She said, "You what?" I said, "I was just embarrassed, I did whatever, and I want you to walk around thinking, you know, this, whatever, and I want you to know the kind of person you're actually dating, right?" And she said, "But you lied to me." She said, "Chris, a ballerina has 10 years. I only have 10 years of a professional dance life. After that, like their feet break down, their whatever, that's it. That's all they get at that level." And she goes, "I'm 6 years into it. I need to be able to trust whoever is lifting me, whoever I'm jumping to, that you're going to be there for me. I don't trust you anymore." I said, "Anything I can do to get that trust back?" She said, "No." Because everybody has a shit tolerance level, right? Everybody has a shit tolerance level. That was hers. She said, "You will not jeopardize my career." She walked right over to the director and she goes, she never looked at me again, and she says, "Please tell him that I'm never dancing with him again." And the director looked at me and said, "Dude, Chris, I don't know what you did, but you fucked up." I'm like, "But what, whatever." And he goes, "Major star, company member, major star, company, no." And I never could get past that next level. I had to leave, go to another company, right? And I called Bill and I was like, "You got me fired, you asshole." Right? He goes, "No, you got yourself fired." He said, "But I'm proud of you." He said, "Did you thank her?" I said, "Thank her for what? For what?" And he said, "She, like, held you accountable. She believed that you were capable of dealing with the consequence. She didn't just lie. And she role modeled taking care of yourself and having a boundary and a shit tolerance level. You need to lower yours in relationship, Chris. And in life in general. So thank her as you walk out the door." And I did that to her. I said, "You know, I did thank you for teaching me some really great lessons, Darcy. I needed to learn this." And everything. She goes, "That's great. Bye." Never talk to me again. Right? But she had a right to. I was jeopardizing her career. Okay? So real quickly, like, I'm going to go over this next part here, okay? I'm trying to get done here in 8 minutes with this so we can get you out. This right here, so, like, all these five parts of ourselves that we work on, intellectual, social, spiritual, you know, mental, and the physical. Bill said to me, he said, "Chris, just being around other recovering people, you're working on the spiritual and the social. Physically, if you're not using your body's healing itself, you're starting to challenge your thinking, is what we work on, and, you know, like stinky thinking and all that kind of stuff." And so he said, "But emotionally, you are whatever age you are in when you start recovery that you were when you started to rely on alcohol and drugs. When you started to get dependent to cope, to problem solve, to get through your feelings, okay? Stress, anxiety, boredom, anything like that where you got more reliant on it, that's when you stop growing emotionally. So when did you start relying on alcohol and drugs? I said, 10, shit, I'm a 25-year-old, 10-year-old. Right, you know what I mean? Like, and he says, yeah. And he said, now you came by it honestly. So he said, you've been in treatment. How many times? I said, 8. He said, so what did they tell you about your natural feelings? What are your natural feelings? What are your natural emotions? I go, I don't know. He goes, when you're overwhelmed, how do you slow down? How do you like reconsolidate? How do you get back to like what those are? And I go, I don't know. He said he thought that was a crime. I should get all my money back from treatment. So he said, so I like this because like I got a lot of tools from him that were given to him in real early recovery too, like way back in 1950. His sponsor gave this to him in 1950. Right? So he said, Chris, my sponsor gave this to me, I'm going to give it to you. This is what men never get taught growing up about our feelings. He said, all the feelings on the left side here, these natural emotions, he said, emotions are just energy in motion. Right? Feelings you can't create or destroy. But he said, all of these over here are just healthy responses to your environment that teach you how to respond or what you need in the moment. Okay? All of these over here on the left side serve you. If you grow up in a family when you're overwhelmed, upset, concerned, you know, as a kid, they actually slow down and help you figure out what you're feeling over here and guide you toward what you need and help you get that. That's a healthy adult's job. If you grew up in a home, though, like you did, abusive, unavailable, neglectful, addicted, they're not in touch with their feelings. You know, it's all saying you can only take people as far as you've gone. For some people, it's a short trip, right? And so he said, your family didn't know how to do this. So everybody started living over here because when you grab alcohol or drugs, codependency, any other addictive behavior or self-destructive behavior, you push down your feelings. So at 10, like, I started getting high and drinking because if I didn't, I would have killed my dad or myself, right? That's how crazy and violent he was. So it was like, at the time it was brilliant because it was the only thing in my environment. There were no healthy adults showing up. How are you feeling? What do you need? Like, can you imagine, like, if you have a 10-year-old that came up to you and said, I got to get drunk or high, just get through the day, Dad? Would you tell them to shut the fuck up? That's not what a healthy parent does. Okay? So, he said, all of these over here promote you, and when you start drinking, using whatever it is outside of yourself to push that down, you start living over here on this side. So the first one is just unconditional love. And unconditional love is just being able to name whatever's going on. You're allowed to talk about it while you grow up, and they promote you. You're allowed to be upset. You're allowed to be concerned or afraid or scared or hurt or angry or whatever. You're allowed to own that. And they don't say, big boys don't cry. Just cheer up and get over it. Shut up, don't talk about it. What's going on is what they do. If you don't get that, you're told that you don't matter. So what happens is you start living over here on this repressed emotional side where you start getting possessive, jealous. Your self-esteem goes down. So that when anybody expresses love or concern to you as you grow up, you start getting like, oh, I need that, right? I have this huge void inside of me. So you turn to relationship or other things outside of you, and you start going, if I just find the right person, I could be happy. And then when you get them, you become possessive and jealous. Some people do it with money, right? If money defines you, there's never enough of it. If it enhances your life, usually what you have is enough. But if it defines you, there'll never be enough because it's looking outside yourself still. It could go away. Right? So you become a hoarder, you become possessive, you're jealous. People do it in relationships all the time. I'm so, got this emotional hole inside of me. I found the right woman. Oh, no. She can't make me happy. She must be doing something wrong. I'll just get more possessive and jealous and like, ah, like that, right? So we get threatened by them looking out for their own comfort. All right. Fear, healthy fear is just being realistically cautious, crossing the street, like starting relationships. It's okay to be cautious, right? Because everybody's personality walks through the door, then you got to see what their character's really like over time. That just takes time. All right. The biggest fear that men are taught in our society is making a mistake. Men are supposed to always get it right. And if you grew up punished instead of disciplined when you made a mistake, punished is when you're hurt. There's like some fear or hurt or like some kind of like retribution directed towards you for making a mistake. Mm-hmm. Instead of being taught a discipline is like, what do you need to do with that mistake? How are you going to take responsibility for that? How are you going to be accountable? It's uncomfortable, but it's not the same thing as pain, fear, trauma. Like getting, so if you grew up like that, you didn't grow up being disciplined. So what you start fear is making a mistake. And, you know, and then especially if you've been, like, when I was in the system, like, you know, you get treated like a number, right? Not a person. Don't make a mistake. Don't talk about, whoa, whatever that is. You get real fearful. So what happens is that, like, any time that we start feeling even healthy fear, we start to feel, the first thing that we feel is panic. So, you know you have this, if somebody says to you sometimes, like, let's say you have a boss that says, hey, you know what? I need to talk to you about something. Can we go in my office? And you're like, what? Or you're dating somebody or living with somebody and they say, hey, when you get home, we need to talk about something, okay, all right? Can we talk about something when you get home? And they go, what are we going to talk about? Oh, don't worry, it's not a big deal. I'll see you when you get home. And then you go, I may as well not go to work. Like, if you can't tell me what it's going to be about, I'm going to panic. Right? And so you start getting perfectionistic here. And you start procrastinating, and you go, I'm not going to make a decision until I know I can make the right one. You get real good at reading people, reading rooms, like, what do you need me to say? So we learned to develop compliance. Oh, is that what you need to hear to feel better? Okay, I'll say that. Yeah, yeah. And we become chameleons, right? Mm-hmm. And we can get get paralyzed, stuck in our fear. All right? Healthy anger is just setting boundaries and limits. When those get stepped over as a kid, you're taught how to be assertive, okay? Addicts become rageful. We're taught to push that down. We're not allowed to own if we've been stepped on or stepped over. So what happens is that we develop rage and resentment, which you either direct towards yourself or other people, okay? And the only people that will accept your rage are who?
Right.
People you love, people that love you, right? And we find that we don't usually direct we become passive with people who have authority over us that can take things away from us, right? Like I never yelled at a judge in court. Mm. I never told the judge, yeah, really? You think I'm going to follow that once I'm off it? Like, fuck you. Okay. I never said that. I was like, yes, sir. Yes, Your Honor. Is that what you need to hear? Okay, I'll tell you. Oh, whatever. Okay. So we get really good at doing that. Okay. The only people we get big with are people who will take it, okay? But even then, they have a shit tolerance level, like we talked about, okay? Grief is just having your losses publicly validated. What's the biggest loss for addicts the first 2 years of recovery? We've talked about it before, if you've been here.
Release.
What's that?
Relationship with the drug.
But what about your relationship with your drug? Instant
gratification.
Nope, not gratification.
Relief.
Do you feel better about yourself if you break your promise to yourself or somebody else the next day or smoke up the rent or do the whatever? That's not gratifying.
Guilt.
Shame.
Instant relief.
Relief.
It will always stimulate your pleasure center. That is the biggest loss the first 2 years of recovery. But when you don't have that, it feels really overwhelming, especially if the using part of your brain's waking up. It feels really overwhelming. If you don't have somebody that looks at you in that moment and go, why wouldn't you miss it? You know you're not doing anything wrong. Why me is not self-pity. Poor me is self-pity. Oh, I might as well just give up. Why do I have to do this? Why whatever? It's the anger phase of grief. Denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. I love it at camp corrections when people come in and are ouchy and grouchy. When they're mad and pissed off, it scares all the other therapists who are like, what? Like they, oh, they're getting big. And I go, yeah, send them to my class. Right? I'll work with that any day. Because that person's real. I hate you. I hate this place. I go, oh, you haven't given up, dude. You still care, like, that people have authority over you. I worry about the people that come in and go, oh, whatever. They're just giving up. That's a lot longer road back to self-care. I was like, give me the ouchie and grouchie every day. You don't even know that that's easier to work with. All I gotta do is go, why wouldn't you be pissed? Isn't that awesome, man? And they'll go, what? I'll just be as mad as you want to be in here. Now, you're just not allowed to be mean, right? I'm not a mean person, so you can't be mean to me. But you can tell me you're pissed. You can tell me you hate everything about this program. I wouldn't want to do it. I'd rather do three huts and a cot than community corrections. That's just me, though, okay? Because I'm lazy, all right? So, I know it. I just know me, okay? And then there's hope, admiration, and envy. You're taught to, like, when you're growing up, this is what success looks like to me. What does it look like to you? You're encouraged to explore your talent, your gifts, and your skills. And you start to go, there's possibility, right? If you're not, you grow up, and you're, like, you know, always in that deprivation state. You go, well, where's mine? And you get a sense of entitlement, and you get, like, you get jealous, and you get, I don't want you to have it. If I can't have it, you can't have it, okay? So here's how you start healing this. Here's how most traditional treatment centers keep you stuck. They come in and say, let's talk about all this. Write a life story. Tell me about all the horrible things going on in your life right now. Tell me, like, yeah, let's talk more about all the negative stuff, blah, blah, blah. Well, they're asking you to sit in a dirty diaper. Shit stinks, but it's warm. If you sit in it, okay? So the way you get from here back to here is you talk about, you name this, right? Then you go and identify the healthy emotion behind it, okay? Like, I grew up incredibly sexually abused by my dad and physically abused by him for years, okay? And he would do crazy things, like we could play Russian roulette with a loaded gun when he was drunk. I mean, it's just a miracle none of us are dead. He was insane. When I say a concentration camp, told you're supposed to love the guard, it really was, okay? So, when I was, like, first getting sober, I had all this rage, right? And, like, I had just had this explosive temper. I became sent to anger management classes. And I'm going to finish with this story, and then we're done. This woman came. I worked with this therapist, right? And I got sent again for anger management because I went off on a PO, right? Called her a fucking bitch. And I got all big, right? And they told me, if you don't go there, you're going to go sit sometime. And I was like, oh, all right. So I go in, and she goes, now, Chris, I've read your history and all of your sexual abuse and blah, 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 and all this physical trauma and all these other things and, you know, the fear you were put in. And you have all this rage that I guess you've just never real primal rage, she used to call it, right? She called it primal, right? That you've never really, like, been able to express. So what we're going to do is, she had all these, like, family dolls on the wall. She said, see this daddy doll? We're going to take it out. And we're going to put it in a chair right here. And then she gave me this stick with a big, like, pillow on the end of it. It's called a bataka stick. She goes, now you go over and you just hit that doll and you tell your dad everything that you should have been able to tell him when you were a kid and all this other kind of stuff. And I'm going, I don't want to be violent like my dad. That's not my goal here, right? And I'm like, that just seems dumb. And she said, oh, are we resisting? Are you resistant? Do I have to write this in your probation report? Like, shame, shame, shame. I was like, oh, fuck, all right, you know. So I go over, I don't know how long you're supposed to do it, right? Oh, 10 minutes is good, I guess. That's a long time, let me tell you. Try it sometime. Just take something for 10 minutes and try to, like, be angry, okay? It was... Oh my God, I thought I should have just done 5, right? You know, I looked up and I was like, oh crap. You know, the time goes really slow. So I thought, oh, you asshole, I hit him and do all these things and everything. And afterwards I'm like, oh. And I know in her best ignorant, I know she wasn't a mean person, but she just leans forward and she goes, and how do we feel now, right? And I swear, I always tell people as a therapist that if I ever ask you that question, you can punch me. And how do we feel now? Right? Bang! Right? Okay. So, I looked at her and I just said, well, I was trying to be honest. And I just said, well, really sweaty and kind of stupid. Right? Really, I was like, oh, I'm worn out. And I felt dumb. And she says, oh my God. She says, oh, you are more wounded and damaged. She called me damaged. Right? Like I'm a broken window. She totally dehumanized me and demeaned me and said, you're more damaged and wounded than I thought. I think we need to do some pentothal, you know, like sodium pentothal, like age regression therapy to get you back to an honest place for when you were like, you know, started getting sexually noticed by your dad at 3 years old, right? Blah, blah, blah. Like, and we need to take you back there and like do this, whatever. And I, that's when I lost it, right? And I just looked at her and I said, oh, to hell with this. You are not helping me. I haven't come in here for 6 months and spent more money. I could have taken all the money I spent in 6 months here, gone to Hawaii for 3 weeks, had a fabulous vacation, and come back feeling better than this bullshit, right? And she goes, oh, oh, you are like, I don't know how much hope there is for you. She actually said that to me, right? And I walked out, and I went back to my PO, and I said, if you ever send me back to that woman again, I'll just go to, I don't care. I'll go to prison for like, I don't care, right? It's got to be better than sitting in that office with that woman. Okay. And that's when I went to my sponsor, and he's like, what's going on with you? Why are you dealing with all the anger? And I sat there, and I went, that's when he showed me this, right? He goes, oh, my God, Chris, you just got tanked. You just got, like, all these, like, she, wow. Like, he said, that's what I hate about our profession, is they don't equip people. They don't teach you. They're, like, all she had to say... Like, all she had to say, like, when you're angry, is if somebody's stepping over a boundary with you, she has to teach you how to be assertive. To go back and say, I'm feeling rage, I'm feeling passive, I'm feeling, you know, whatever. Identify that, and then go back and say, what boundary just got stepped over? And how do you set that boundary and reinforce it? You don't have that skill. You don't know how to do that. But now you have a barometer. Whenever you want to run away from a conflict or beat the hell out of somebody, you just know somebody stepped over a boundary. Let's get that skill, right? So that's a huge part of recovery for us as men. And it's a process of getting in touch with these things and learning how to do these skills better, okay? So clean is where we start. Sobriety is a process for the rest of our life. Because the only thing that changes and that stays constant in most people's character is their moral code. What's right versus wrong, okay? Your values are gonna shift. I hope that's what's important to you now isn't the same thing that is important to you 15 years from now. You haven't grown, right? And your balance in life, your integrity is just gonna change every day depending on if you get a cold. Your physical self can like interfere with your emotional self. Socially, relationships change, right? Intellectually, stinking thinking just comes up all the time. So, those two things are always going to change, and you got to work on maintaining the balance with those and keeping the healing going and moving forward. That's the goal in recovery. Then you can maintain your character, manage your personality, and move forward. So, cool. Oh my God, it's late. Go, go. Sorry, guys. Thanks.